right, folks, I'm going to ask to call your attention here. We're going to get things going. This is a new experience for us because this is the first time ever that we are recording one of these and hopefully sharing it online with a wide group of people that have already expressed their interest after we sent out our e-newsletter the other day in watching this on YouTube. So we're going to be futzing a little bit with technology here, and thanks for bearing with us while we do that. But just to get things started, I want to say welcome. It's great to have all of you here. My name is Jen Kobolecki. I'm the education coordinator here at the Aldo Leopold Foundation. And we run these brown bag seminars from time to time when we have the opportunity to bring various scholars from different backgrounds to our audiences to share their perspectives on Leopold's land ethic in a variety of different fields in the 21st century. So it's an exciting opportunity for us to have Jonathan Beever here from Purdue University, where he is working on his Ph.D. in environmental ethics. He's been a visiting scholar with us here for the last month or so, and we've really enjoyed having him around. And we're here now to let Jonathan tell you about the work that he's done and apply that to how we think about ethics and the way that we value the natural world. And for those of you watching us online, welcome. We're glad to have you here too. These kinds of programs for all of you are supported by our members. We are a member-supported organization, and we want to thank all of you that are members and help us bring programs like this to our community for no cost, and it's just a really delightful opportunity to be able to share this with everybody. So we encourage questions. This program is for you, and once again, thanks for coming, and I will turn it over now to Jonathan. So join me in welcoming him.
Thank you, Jen, and thank you everybody for having me. Nice to come on such a nice day. It's been a pleasure and an honor for me to be here at the Leopold Foundation for the past month or so. I'm also really happy to be that you're willing to have me talk about environmental ethics for an hour or so. I really appreciate that. So as Jen mentioned, I am a PhD student at Purdue, and I'm a philosopher. And I wanted to get that out of the way right away because I heard that the first step to recovery is just admitting you have a problem. So now that we're all on the same page, I'm going to do two things today. I think if most of you, if you think of philosophers, if I had to guess, you think of Rodin, right, the thinker, the guy with his fist in his chin, sitting there in eternity, never moving, thinking deep thoughts, very profound. That's not the sort of philosopher I've turned into yet. Maybe someday I'll be immortalized in stone. We can only hope. But for now, I'm more interested in the applied side of philosophy, especially in ethics. So that's why my interest in environmental ethics developed, and that's why I was interested in coming here and working with Buddy and the crew at ALF. And in the Legacy Center here, it's been really wonderful. So philosophers have a particular job to do, I think, and a legacy that goes well beyond wrapping our arms around books and baring our chins and our fists and thinking deep thoughts. And that's the work of applied ethics. So today I want to tell you a two-part story in applied ethics. The first part is going to be historical, sort of. And the second part is going to be a little more controversial, which is my own angle on these questions. So I'm going to do this in two parts for two reasons. First, so that the people watching online will have a sense where the break is going to be. I'll try to indicate that. And second, so that if you want to leave for the second part, you're more than welcome. So let me start with two stories to warm us up. We sense that these two piles of sawdust were something more than wood, that they were the integrated transect of a century, that our saw was biting its way, stroke by stroke, decade by decade, into the chronology of a lifetime, written in concentric annual rings of good oak. This passage is from Aldo Leopold, from the story of the good oak, which I think is the February entry in what became the Sand County Almanac. I want to tell you this story for several reasons. Does anybody know the story of the good oak? Has anybody read it in Sand County? ALFers don't count. You're all required to. The story, as Leopold tells it, this is just one brief passage. The story, as Leopold tells it, he's sitting in front of a fire, burning a log with his next to his dog, and they're thinking, the dog's, he sort of says, he and the dog are both thinking, and the dog is thinking, gee, it's nice to be warm. Leopold's thinking that too, but Leopold's also thinking about that log, and he's sort of thinking back to where that firewood came from. And so the good oak, the passage in the Sand County Almanac, is about more than firewood, clearly. It's about firewood, it's about him being warm next to a fire, appreciating the use that he's getting from this tree. But it's a story about history, too. This stroke by stroke, decade by decade, the story is broken up as he's cutting through this tree that got this good oak that got hit by lightning and died. As he's cutting it down, he's thinking about its history, its life cycle. He's thinking about it as an individual. And so to me, this is a story about value. It's not just about firewood, it's about value. The second story is very related.
Well, I see a beautiful shapely tree, I sure do. I did. It's half gone now. But it was all, you know, like that. So many limbs and so beautifully shaped. I feel so proud that we kept him so long, because he was so diseased so many times. Dutch elm disease is coming. It's going to be disastrous. That was 1956. I was keeping such close eye, as I say. My wife said that tree's name was Susie. I would be real jealous. But she loved Herbie as much as I did. It was just great. But nothing is forever. I'm just grateful we had him so long, and his time has come, and mine is about due too. I'm honoring one. And the strange thing is, my father died when I was 3, my mother died when I was 4. I don't remember either one of my parents. My grandmother brought me up, she died.
It's more for me. It's more. It's about the tree, but it's also about Frank. So, I mean, it's my feelings are attached to Frank. He loves the tree. I love Frank. So,
nothing is forever. I don't want anybody to grieve when I go. Just be glad I could do what I did while I was here, and I'm just very thankful that we had Herbie so long. He gets so well known and brought so much, brought a lot of people to the town. And yeah, so I'm 101, but I try to enjoy every day. And yeah.
I want to share that story with you because I originally am from Maine, and so it hit a soft spot when it came up in 2010. Frank Knight is 101. He passed away this year at 103. Herbie, the tree that this story is about, passed away in 2010. Frank was 103. He'd been taking care of Herbie personally for 50 years. He had inoculated it against 16 rounds of Dutch elm disease, trimming branches, cleaning, injecting into the hardwood. The tree, when it died, was 217 years old. It was 110 feet tall with a 120-foot crown and 7-foot diameter trunk. Now, I think for most trees that die, they die, if they are hit by lightning, they become somebody's firewood. If they're taken down, they become somebody's lumber, somebody's furniture. This tree in particular, and stories like this tree and the good oak, are reasons why I think talking about environmental value is so important. Because there's something else going on here, I think. And that something else is the purpose of the talk today. It's really interesting to me, too, to have heard stories while being here about the good oak. When the Legacy Center was built 2 or 3 times, I think, pieces of the good oak were returned to the center that people had taken from the stump after it was cut, or pieces of memorabilia people had walked away with were returned here, home. I mean, the good oak was grown just a mile down the road here near the shack. So when Herbie was cut down, the whole community came out in celebration, sort of, or in mourning, I guess. The wood was donated, the tree was cut down for free, which is no small feat for a tree that big. The wood was donated to local craftspeople, and a community enrichment project was developed. And so you can still buy baseball bats and coasters and tables made from the good oak in support of Yarmouth, the community where it was founded and where Frank lived. And in 2012, when Frank passed away, they made a coffin out of the good oak, and he was buried in that. And I think it's stories like that that connect communities, right? It really draws out the feeling that it's not just about Frank, and it's not just about Yarmouth, the community, but it's about the relationship to this one tree, this one thing. So it's kind of to me it's been, if you can't tell, a really touching story, and I think part of that's just my own sort of emotional connection to nature and to wilderness and to being outside. But I think it also indicates something bigger than me, something cultural that's developed. And this is the story, if I could get across anything at all today, it's that this is a story about development. 150 years ago, if you remember pictures that you've seen, if you've taken shack tours of the Wisconsin River and the trees being, the lumber being floated down the Wisconsin, people didn't have relationships to trees like this. And that's why the good oak, written in the, I don't know when it was written, I guess, but published in the late 40s, written a little bit earlier, is such a powerful thing. And it has to do with ethics. I mean, that's I say that not because I'm a philosopher and I do ethics, but I think that there's something rich going on in that story. So I'm going to back into this question, what's valuable about this tree, the sort of the question that I'm getting at today, by talking first a little bit about what ethics is. Again, a quote from Leopold, because he also backed into the idea, starting from his work on the land, backing into the idea of ethics and the idea of value. If I had to define it for you, I'd say that ethics is the systematic study of the coherence and consistency of our moral beliefs. To unpack that, it's the study of the things we value morally. It's not just a willy-nilly study. Philosophers try to be systematic about this. There are theories of ethics created, for instance. We're trying to be coherent and consistent. We want things to hold together. The principles and rules that we develop, we want them to hold together as a set. And we also want to be consistent. We also want the rules and principles we design around value to align well with other values and other things we care about. And ethics come in several forms. Everybody has a personal set of ethics. Those are the ethics that we develop as children, as we grow up, as we, from our family and friends, sort of the our upbringing. That's where our personal ethics comes from. Societal ethics is at another level. Societal ethics develops in communities larger than your family set. This could be regional. This could be national. We've got at least two sets of societal ethics going on in the United States that are constantly at odds. At least. And then there's the third level, professional ethics. And these ethics are codes that develop within professions. The clearest example of this is in the medical community, where physicians have codes of ethics that they have to follow. Those are some of the earliest to develop historically and in the United States. But now almost every professional organization has a code of ethics. And I think professional groups, just like the rest of us, are trying to figure out exactly what that means and exactly what they need to think about. So ethics try to give us rules or principles or maxims to guide our behavior. And the last point I wanted to make before moving on is that these principles, rules, and maxims don't develop. They're not eternal, they're not static, they're not things we discover, but they're things we create. They're things we develop over time and in particular contexts. And that's a point that is itself controversial, because there are some philosophers, and I think a lot of us too, who think things like, for instance, the golden rule is an eternal, unchanging, universal rule for right action. That rule or versions of it appear in almost every major culture in the world and have throughout history. So there's a little bit of flexibility there, but I think the codes that we deal with, the ethics we deal with, develop in time and in context. Of course, I gave you a definition that itself requires definition. So just to unpack that a little more, moral beliefs. These are our intuitions that we've reflected upon, that we've considered, that concern right and wrong, good and bad, just and unjust, the sort of meat and potatoes of ethics. And of course, one more level, and the final level, what are intuitions? And intuitions are what ground this entire discussion. And I think anytime we're talking about things like Herbie or the Good Oak or any other case of ethical concern, we're thinking really at root about intuitions. And these are gut feelings, gut reactions. If somebody says to you, Herbie was worthless, that article, that video story was foolish, nobody should have made it. Or if somebody says, Leopold was a fool, he should have just been disposed of as trash. We have gut reactions to comments like that. Any comments like that at that level. And those say something, those speak at a pre-reflective level. So we're not consciously discussing it or rationalizing it or thinking about it. But our gut reactions tell us about something that we value. And again, the story I'm telling you here is that our gut reactions aren't static, aren't eternal, we weren't born with them. They too develop in context. So my particular field of interest is bioethics. And bioethics is, I'm going to tell you a brief story about it in a minute, but to give you a definition up front, it's the definition of ethics, but focused on the living world. So still systematic, still worried about coherence and consistency, still worried about our moral beliefs, but with a focus on the living world. And the same things apply. The story of bioethics develops in context over time. It offers us, tries to offer us rules for action or reasons to act, and it happens at least three levels. So I've given you an overview of ethics now, but we talk a lot and people write often about values. And this happens in politics more and more. It's happening in academia and in every profession. But it's good to be clear about what we're talking about as far as values. I've offered you, nothing I say in this presentation, by the way, is going to be the truth, quote unquote. It's my perspective on these issues. So I've given you a brief taxonomy, a classification here of the types of value that I think are important to consider. It's not exclusive. But there are things like aesthetic value. And we're concerned here with the beautiful, the things that affect us emotionally. We're worried about economic value, what things are worth. I just found out that Governor Mitch Daniels will be the president of Purdue University, and there's been a lot of controversy around that because he's very, very focused on economics. He turned Indiana's economy around, right? And there's good questions about the sort of value we should be focused on in academia. That's my polemicizing, I'll stop. But I think economic value is a big one, right? This is something when Leopold was writing, this is what Leopold was writing against. The economic valuation of things like the forests and trees and rivers and ecosystems. Those first two are non-moral, I think I can safely say. The last two that I want to mention, instrumental and intrinsic, are moral. These are terms we use to describe types of moral value. Instrumental value is use value. It's value for another. So you could offer an example like your barista at the coffee shop, right? Your barista, he or she, barrister or barista, whichever, has instrumental value to you. He or she provides your coffee in the morning, provides a service to you. So they're useful to you. In that sense, they're valuable. There's another level, and this is the fourth level here, the intrinsic value level. This is the level I'd like to focus on. I'd like us to think about more in depth for the rest of this presentation. All four are interrelated. They're never distinguished from, they're never cleanly distinguished from one another, but it's a question of priorities. Let me give you an example quickly to get a sense of what I'm talking about. If you compare the four statements I have up here, let's start with that coffee is good, going back to my barista story. That coffee is good. What I mean here is perhaps it's aesthetically good. It makes me feel good. The steam coming off it is beautiful to me. Maybe there's a design in the foam on the top. It might be economically good. It might be cost effective or worth its money. It might be instrumentally good. It might wake me up in the morning. But it's hard to say that that coffee is intrinsically good. That is to say that there's something about the coffee, independently of its relationship to me, that's good, that's morally valuable. Compare that statement then to the statement, Leopold is a good man. Again, you could tell a story. He may have been one handsome gentleman, and he may have aesthetic value to lots of people. One could argue he has economic value. He published books that are bringing in income for families and foundations and things. Economically valuable. You might think he's instrumentally valuable as a father, as a husband, as a leader in the community, right? He's good for other people. But if we stopped there, I think we'd be missing something very important about Leopold. And I'm using Leopold, of course, just as one example. I think there's something else. If Leopold hadn't been instrumentally good, if he hadn't written books and brought money in that was economically valuable, and if he'd been one ugly dude with no aesthetic value at all, he'd still be, you could say, a good man, right? There's something about Leopold, independent of its relationship to other things, that's good. And this is the question, the problem, the idea of intrinsic value. I want to give you two other examples that I have up here, and then we'll move on. But consider Ashton, a cat I met recently, thanks to the Huffakers. You might say Ashton is a good cat. And again, you could tell... I might say Ashton is a good cat. And again, you could tell the same story that we've told about the coffee and about Leopold. And the question is, again, where you stop, right? What set of these values do you want to apply to Ashton the cat? Or Bubba the dog? Or, I don't know the names of your chickens, but your chickens, right? And this is the story about animal rights, animal value. And then we're going to push that, of course, since my interest is in environmental ethics, one step further and ask the exact same question. What do we mean? What did Leopold mean when he said the good oak? And if I had to wager a guess, I would say, just like Herbie, Leopold meant all of that. And so what we have to do, what my job is as a philosopher, is trying to understand the relationships between those things, and also specifically, what the heck we mean by intrinsic value. So let me give you a little, again, sort of backing into it historically, a little bit of an overview about why we care about intrinsic value at all. Bioethics was developed in two different locations, in two different avenues, less than a year apart. Andre Heliger's up at Georgetown in what became the Kennedy Institute for Bioethics, a really famous medical ethics site, developed the term bioethics in collaboration with his colleagues to describe rights and duties around medical ethics, doctor-patient relationships, basically. How do we treat, or how should we treat, patients and health professionals? How do we treat research subjects? How do we develop good guidelines and policies to keep people safe? But that seemed to be a limited view, and an hour south from here, a year earlier, Van Rensselaer Potter at Madison also coined the term, wrote several papers and at least two books about it. And he, Ponder was a cancer researcher at Madison, and he used the term ecological and environmental concerns. So the model of bioethics he was developing was trying to account for a much broader range of things than that developed at the Kennedy Institute. So Potter was interested in prevention, not just reaction to things, not just therapy, and he was interested not just in problem solving, but in developing wisdom, understanding, knowledge of the way the world is. It's a much broader vision and has much wider implications. But neither of these two views developed, out of the blue or out of context. So let me contextualize briefly. Everybody knows of the Tuskegee syphilis study in the early 30s. That was a study that ran from 1932 to 1972, 40-year study, of about 600 mainly African, primarily African-American males in Tuskegee, Alabama. As of 1972, there were 64, I think, of those individuals still alive. And the really interesting thing from an ethics standpoint, well, there are countless interesting things about Tuskegee from an ethics standpoint, but one of them surely has to be that penicillin was discovered as an effective cure for syphilis halfway through that study. It was never offered as a cure to these patients, and so there was a hubbubaloo, right? People, and this was all done, it wasn't done out of malice. There's nothing malicious about this study. Nobody thought, oh boy, let's go get them. right? This was a step in the progress of science. Scientists wanted to understand the disease, what it did over the course of its lifetime, life cycle, how it affected patients. And they found a population where there was a high prevalence of syphilis, and they went to study it. That doesn't happen anymore, right? Step one in the story. Step two in the story, 1939, the human subjects research that happened in light of World War II and the resulting doctor's trials. Won't even get into the details on those. But again, these are things that the entire world stood up and said, no, that can't happen, right? You can't treat people like that, is the sentiment. Now, if you think back to my taxonomy of value there, why can't you treat people like that? And the answer that's now commonly given is the idea of human dignity. And that idea is neither aesthetic nor economic nor instrumental. It has to do with the intrinsic value of human beings. We can't treat people like that because they're people. Willowbrook was a similar Willowbrook, New York community for the handicapped children, mentally handicapped children. There was a ongoing hepatitis outbreak at the school. Scientists again thought, oh, easy population to study, let's go do that. It was a much shorter lived study. Still, got some throwback. And if we stop there, we'd be describing what Andrea Heliger's decided was bioethics. This is ethics having to do, questions about value, again, having to do with human-human relationships. How should we act towards human beings? That's the question Heliger's was interested in. And that's the direction medical ethics has taken. Potter complicates the story beyond my simple timeline here, so I'm only going to offer you a few more things to really confuse it. Potter and those of us interested in a broader vision of bioethics, a broader vision of questions of intrinsic value, are concerned with things like atomic bomb development, Hiroshima and Nagasaki in 45. Sand County Almanac is in that picture in 48. The development or the understanding of DNA later in the century, same thing. Rachel Carson's famous Silent Spring, where she basically studied the ecological effects of DDT with a moral undertone. And then the famous Unnecessary Fuss. Do people know this video? Unnecessary Fuss was a video made by the ALF, not the Aldo Leopold Foundation, but the Animal Liberation Front in the early 80s. And it was a result of, I want to make sure I've got my details right. University of Pennsylvania has a, either that or Penn State, has a famous head trauma research center. And they were doing head trauma research on primates. And so ALF decided this was not a good thing. They had moral qualms with it. And so they broke in and stole 60 hours of videotape that they edited down to 18 minutes, I think, and released as Unnecessary Fuss. And Unnecessary Fuss comes from the opinion of one scientist quoted in that video who says, we don't understand what's going on. It all seems unnecessary, like unnecessary fuss. And this video was all the bad things that researchers do that they're not supposed to, outside of the experimental purview, injuring, creating head trauma in primates. And this was a big moment. And so you could keep going. I could fill out this timeline all day long, but that would be boring. What I'm trying to get at with this picture is that we're talking about moral value. We're talking about an extensionism that's happening. And this is, again, not an unchallenged picture, but the story I want to tell is one of progress, of the development of moral value, of moral considerability. So we started with concern about human beings. And you could tell a much richer picture than the one I have on the board here. We started with concern, moral value being inherent and intrinsic to white landowning males. Those are the folks that got rights accorded to them. And slowly over time, that picture developed. And it wasn't until the 1960s and 1970s where the animal rights movement really took off and people started at the societal level, again, societal ethics at the societal level, started worrying about asking questions about the intrinsic value of non-humans. And it wasn't until a decade or so after that that the next sort of expansion happened and people started questioning, coming back to Leopold, and questioning intrinsic value in not only humans and not only non-human animals, but non-humans in general, including the environment. It's a really interesting picture and really complicated picture. Because if I ask you, I sometimes ask my students, okay, so after I've described this to them, all right, human beings have intrinsic value, and they say, oh yeah, sure, sure. How about Ashton the cat? And most of them say, because they have pets, they say, yeah, I think so, sure. Intrinsic value, check. I say, okay, how about a chicken or a pig at a farm? And they say, well, you know, because most of them are meat eaters, and you think, well, and this is important, right? Because all of a sudden, you see when they pause, you see them thinking, okay, wait, there's a conflict here, right? I eat chickens and cows, and yet we've been telling this story about intrinsic value of non-human animals, and I don't know how those line up. So I leave them with that, and then I say, okay, so let's just say they do, because they're similar to your dog and cat in a lot of ways, right? Pigs are at least as smart as dogs. How about, in this context, deer and crane and wolves, right? How about intrinsic value for them? And then there's a lot of throwback, right? Because you have not only the meat eaters, but the sporting enthusiasts. This is a conflict Leopold faced in his writing constantly, right? As a hunter himself and an outdoorsman. And you get them thinking about that level, and you say, okay, how about carp and bass in the ponds, right? Intrinsic value? And it gets really fuzzy. And you get down to Herbie and the good oak, and the question just becomes so vague and incoherent, it's hard to make any headway at all. Because I think what's happened is the question of intrinsic value is based on analogy, right? I know I'm intrinsically valuable, and I hope you all know you're intrinsically valuable too, right? And it's because of that knowledge that I have, or that belief I have for myself, that I also believe all of you are intrinsically valuable. And because of the analogical similarities between me and Ashton the cat, I'm pretty darn certain Ashton also has intrinsic value. The farther you get away from me, when you get down to fish and plants and trees and then ecosystems, the analogy breaks down and the story becomes very, very complicated. So one of the big jobs for the environmental ethicist is to tell a coherent and consistent story, develop an ethic around the idea that's going to account for the intrinsic value of the environment. And it's not an easy thing to do. We could tell a long story, again, about where our intuitions come from. Remember, intuitions are at the base of our ethics. We could tell a long story about how our laws about treatment of humans and then our animal cruelty laws, how those developed and why they developed. And you could tell a story about how that's all intermixed with knowledge of the natural world. Better and better science leads to better and better policy, maybe developing our intuitions, maybe it happens the other way around. But those three things, that picture, is what I'm trying to get at here. I think it's the intersections that are so interesting. The intersections between our ends, our policy, and our intuitions about what's valuable, and our science, in this case, our ecology. So what bioethics is trying to do is basically the same thing that Leopold's land ethic is trying to do. It's trying to push us to think about our intuitions, trying to think about this question of intrinsic value, trying to think about our interrelation, and that's where ecology has come into play. So now I'm going to break. This is the end of my first part. I've tried to tell you a story in the last few minutes about where value comes from, what it means to talk about value, moral value, and the questions that I think are really important. The next part of the presentation, that was sort of a high level, if you want to think of it that way. Part two, I want to focus in a little bit and give you some more detail about at least the way I've been thinking about reasoning about those questions. How do you develop theoretical models around questions like intrinsic value of the environment? So that being said, the next part will be much more philosophy-y. If you'd like to run for the hills, I don't blame you in the least. So I told you the story about intrinsic value. One of the ways, not the only way, but one of the ways you could try to account for intrinsic value is to tell a story about where it comes from. So what accounts for intrinsic value in me? It's normally described as some property or some capacity that I have. And I'm going to tell you a brief history of philosophy story about some of those capacities and how we've developed our thinking. This should not be a surprising story. One of the capacities that often thought wasn't intrinsically valuable and what made me as a human being, human individual, intrinsically valuable was my capacity to reason. René Descartes was really famous for this story, as well as Immanuel Kant. It's got limitations, to say the very least, right? And we could work through those systematically. I'll just mention one way you could account for intrinsic value is to say that reason is what makes us intrinsically valuable. And I might think that because I think I have a capacity for reason and I can think about things like that. And you all might think, yeah, that makes some sense. Holding reason up as an intrinsically valuable capacity or property works, right? Sure, we're all reasonable people. We can all reason. So yeah, check. I'm intrinsically valuable. It accounts for me. Good to go. Of course, if you think about the poor children at Willowbrook or any developmentally challenged individual, human individual who can't reason, they're excluded from this moral club, this moral community, if we're just taking this as the criteria for value. Not to mention, there's the majority, I'm going to say this very tentatively, history has decided that the majority of non-human animals also can't reason, so they're likewise excluded from our club, from our community. Fish, trees, ecosystems, out, right? This is a very narrow view that accounts for some individuals. You might also think, and a lot of people have thought historically, that having a soul is what accounts for intrinsic value, right? Things that have souls are intrinsically valuable, check. And you might also think, well, it's because I think I have a soul, so I'm intrinsically valuable. That seems like a good criteria to go on. St. Thomas Aquinas thought this, and Aquinas sort of thought, human beings, that was it. That was the moral club right there, souls. It's not the only view. There are a lot of other views that thought souls were intrinsically valuable. Really interesting story, though, in the same sort of Catholic worldview. St. Francis of Assisi, I don't know if any of you know the story of St. Francis, but really interesting figure, developed the stigmata, sorts of really kind of crazy stories there. But he used to famously preach to animals, fish, birds, deer, things, right? He used to preach to animals because he thought, similarly, they all owed God something just like we all owed God something as creations. So it's a complicated story, but you might think souls is another criteria you might use. You might also think, a little later on in history, if I'm telling a pseudo-historical story, you might also think consciousness is the criteria. Okay, maybe we weren't right about souls. Maybe reason's not quite the right thing. Consciousness, check, right? It counts for me again. I'm conscious, pretty sure. Pretty sure you're all conscious too, most of the time. So consciousness, the ability, the capacity for consciousness, that's the thing we're going to go on. You might think that only human beings had that, but the story I'm telling here is about, again, an extensionism. So I offer up Baruch Spinoza as an example, a famous philosopher who had a panentheistic story, which is just to say Spinoza thought that God existed in and through everything. And so he equated controversially God with nature. And so he thought everything was a piece of God. God was in a piece of everything, however that works out. And so that everything, right, not just us, not just non-human animals, not just non-human animals, plants and fish, but everything, including tables and the poor unfortunate chair whose soul you broke, was conscious. And people said and still say, that's crazy, right? You're talking about a panpsychism where there's like minds floating about in everything and lamps and rainbows and, I mean, everything. It's a kind of a bizarre notion. Of course, Buddha thought that too, right? So if we're doing an East-West comparison, it's not a singularly crazy view, if you think it's a crazy view. And right here in North America, indigenous people here also had a similar belief. They thought all living things, all natural things were inspirited. They all had consciousness of a particular kind. And so there are really powerful stories in Native American mythos about our relationships, our community, our mutual relationships with the living world. And that is an entirely different worldview than, say, Descartes and Aquinas and the sort of Western Europeans of earlier. Much more recently, give or take, if we're talking about history, sentience has been the capacity that's been held up. Sentience is what's driven the animal rights movement with so much success. Sentience is the capacity to feel and experience pain and pleasure. So people like me, philosophers like me, sort of have been thinking to themselves and telling each other the same story I've been telling you. Reason doesn't quite seem to fit, it's too limiting. Souls doesn't seem to fit, a little less limiting, but still not quite it, right? On and on and on. Sentience seems to be a property that can be described as having moral worth. Pain seems to matter to me, right? If I stub my toe on the table, I care about it, so it's valuable to me. Disvaluable, right? I don't like it, right? And pleasure is likewise valuable to me. So it's a criteria that's supposed to be getting at an understanding of value for the individual that's going to apply to everybody who can feel and experience pleasure and pain. And so for the animal rights community, the question then is, where do you draw the line? Right? So is it at rabbits? Anything less differently evolved than rabbits isn't going to cut it. There's some good evidence that fish feel pain. Really interesting experiments injecting bee venom into the lips of fish and then watching what they do. They rub their mouths on the bottom of the tank. Right? They seem to not like it. So there's sort of behavioral evidence that fish feel pain, neurological evidence. So if pain's what matters, you get a much bigger community. Right? You're no longer talking about just human beings or some subset of non-human animals, but most everything, but not treats. Right? So for the environmental ethicist, sentience isn't going to cut it either. And then you've got Leopold. You've got the idea of biotic stability. Maybe Leopold didn't think of this taxonomy in quite the same way. Maybe he didn't reason to this the same way that I'm trying to lead you. But biotic stability might be held up as another criterion for intrinsic value. So this is a view, I think, held by Leopold, although Kurt might clarify a little bit if he disagrees. What's intrinsically valuable is biotic stability. This is the statement of the land ethic, sort of one of the last things Leopold wrote. It's also a view held by Arne Naess, the developer of the deep ecology movement, who his was a bit more esoteric than Leopold's, a bit less scientific, I guess. But deep ecology purports the same thing, that stability of the whole matters. The whole is what matters. So when you're starting to worry about value, you start from the big and you work to the small. These other options have done the opposite, right? The picture that I drew for you, the bullseye diagram, starts from the small, goes big. So again, this biotic stability notion can be seen as a complete reversal of our ways of thinking about intrinsic value. Rather than starting from the parts and working to the whole, we're starting from the whole and assigning value to the whole. James Lovelock, again, not an uncontroversial figure himself, developed with Lynn Margulis, the famous biologist from Harvard, I think Harvard, the Gaia hypothesis. And this is the hypothesis that the Earth as a whole is a living organism. There's substantial evidence that that theory might hold up. It's still, of course, controversial. And Lovelock, I don't think Lovelock was quite in the business, although I think there's an undertone here, but I don't think Lovelock was quite in the business of ascribing value. He is a scientist. He's trying to understand the world in which we live as in ecological terms. And so he's trying to describe the whole world as you would describe the anatomy of me. All my parts work together to make Jonathan, right? Similarly, all the parts of the world, all the systems within the world work together to make the thing he called Gaia. But I think this story about biotic stability is interesting because it's telling you a story about the whole. And like I said, this is not a complete story. There's a lots of nuance that I'm avoiding for fear of saying more things incorrectly. But it's really interesting to me to back out from the individuals to think at a bigger picture about what they're trying to accomplish. So I mentioned reason covers some individuals. I mean, a subset of us human beings. Souls covers most of us, if you're into that worldview. Consciousness covers all individuals, if you're Spinoza. Sentience, a lot of things. Not plants, again, right? And not all animals, but a lot of animals and all human beings. At least they have the capacity. And biotic stability, interestingly, just covers one. And I think that is the key scientific and moral issue with ecology. So there are lots of folks like myself trying to think about what happens to environmental ethics in the light of ecological science, the science of our interrelations with things in the natural world. And I think the key issue is this individual versus wholes issue. Do we start from the big and then try to tease out why individuals should matter morally, why individuals might have intrinsic value? Or do we take as a datum, as a fact, that individuals do indeed have intrinsic value and then try to tell a story about the whole? And people interested in environmental ethics, for the majority, I think have taken the whole part. They found it easier to tell a story, not an extensionism story, not the story I was telling you about with the bullseye picture, but rather a story from the top. They want to give you an account of why the whole matters, why it's morally important, why it has intrinsic value, and then worry about the rest later. And there's some good sort of political, social, environmental issues for doing that, right? The sooner you can get around to explaining to people and getting people to understand why the environment matters, the sooner we can go out and save it, right? I think that's the idea. But on my view, and again, remember, the second part is my view, on my view, a complete environmental ethic, a complete ecological ethic would take into account, be able to explain both directions. And it's something that neither theories that start from the top, like biotic stability, can do, nor is it theories that start from the individuals. So you need some way of connecting the two, of combining the two. And that's the purpose of my dissertation. And beyond boring doctoral dissertations, I think it's a really important question that a lot of people are asking, not just myself. Again, this is just my story. So, for the next part, part 2B, I guess, I'm going to try to tell you, lead you to where I'm trying to go, if that makes sense. So our endpoint will be tenuous, because I'm still going there myself, but I want to tell you at least how I'm reasoning about it. There seems like I can break these up into two points of reference. Philosophers call these axiological points of reference. Axiology is just the study of value. So they're points of reference that give you value, that describe to you value. And I've, again, just from my view, divided these into two parts. The first part are transcendent capacities or properties. Value comes from outside the natural world. If I have a soul, it's given to me by God or the gods outside of nature, normally conceived. And that's what makes the soul is what's valuable, and source is coming from outside nature. The same can be said of reason on Kant's view and Descartes' view. Reason is a property of us, of human beings, given to us by God, or at least by our rational capacity as human beings. Again, it's sort of an external capacity. It's hard to describe scientifically. It's hard to get a grasp on. Similar stories can be told about consciousness. That's maybe the most controversial point I'll say today. In Spinoza's view, at least, consciousness was something transcendent, to fall back on that word. There's more and more scientific research into what it is to be conscious. So there's good data on what phenomenal consciousness is. Consciousness allows us to experience the world. But I'm still going to lump it together with, for the sake of simplicity, with outside of nature. The last two, I want to say, at least from my perspective again, are immanent. They come from within the natural world. When we're talking about biotic stability, there's nothing external to Gaia. When Lovelock's talking about Gaia, he's talking about just the physical systems of the world that we can explain through science, understand, and explain, I guess, again. And similar story with sentience. Sentience is a capacity. If you push it far enough, it has similar problems, but sentience is a capacity based on our physiological properties. I can feel pleasure and pain, not because it's some capacity given to me from somewhere else. It's just a function of the sort of earthly critter that I am, right? It's the same story you can tell about any other earthly critter with that same capacity, given to them through evolution, explainable by science, imminent to this world. So these give us, again, philosophers like dichotomies, so two lines of thought to follow. I'll follow each in turn. So if we decide we want to go the transcendent route from outside nature, the problem is how to explain scientifically the point of reference. So how do I explain where souls come from if I think we all have souls? How do I explain why they morally matter, who has them, how we can describe them, find out if something has it, loses it, etc., right? If I really think the chair had soul and it then broke, does the chair parts then also have souls? Right, on and on and on. Complicated questions, no direct answers. It's the stuff of philosophy, and it's the stuff of the history of philosophy. These are the ideas historians and philosophers dealt with for 2,000 years or more. So one possible answer to this is that maybe form is enough. Maybe we don't need to worry about justification. We don't care where it comes from. The fact that it's describing something that's important to us is enough. And this is a view that I seems like J. Baird Caldecott takes in a passage where he's describing the land ethic in terms of Native American traditions, specifically the Ojibwa. I think nothing Caldecott said is wrong. I'm just using this example to make a point. So let me focus in on this quote. He says, in form, the Ojibwa land ethic and the land ethic of Leopold are identical. And he thinks that's reason enough that we can take the Ojibwa and the land ethic to be getting at the exact same point, sense of value in the exact same way, good enough for our purposes. So I played a little game. I went into Photoshop and I gave you two outlines. And the point I want to make is that form seems to be meaningless without content, right? So the form of these two outlines is very similar, almost identical. They map onto each other well, just like the Ojibwa land ethic and Leopold's land ethic. But you're missing something, right? Clearly, these are two very different. When you give them context, when you give them detail, and then apply our context to them as well within our social context, they're two very different things. So the content gives meaning to form. Form, very similar. Content couldn't be more different. I hope that point's clearly enough made. I think it's a really, really important point. It says something about the development of ethics in context. So part of my concern, part of my reason for bringing up this example as strongly as I did, was that it seems to be fundamental to me, and maybe it's only fundamental to the argument I'm trying to build, but at least for this, it seems fundamental. The context is really important. Especially in a multicultural world that we live in now, if we're trying to rely on something like Descartes did, like souls, right? It's really hard to describe that in a global sense. If we're trying to get at a global environmental ethic, for instance, there are so many different contexts and so many different people's opinions. We're trying to grasp at something that binds us all together. And form is not going to be it, right? It's got to be something more contextual, contentful than that. And so, does everybody know the expression greenwashing? Does this term come up, right? So greenwashing is the idea that corporate entities might start recycling programs to try to get good publicity. I think sometimes there's reason to worry about ethics, good washing, you might call it, right, rather than greenwashing, where similar things are happening. In the corporate world, in the political world, in the social world, ethics is becoming this go-to word. It's picked up politically all the time in debates. And morality, right? Things have to be moral. But those things are taken out of context, and they're taken with only form. They're just forms of the words, of the concepts. And so we become good-washed, and we think, well, they're talking about morality and ethics. They've got to be doing good things. Yay for them. I'm going to vote particular way in Wisconsin, let's say. But I think that's not right. That's not the whole picture. Content really matters. So that's the point I'm trying to drive home there. And that's the problem, I think, with starting from an outside the natural world, because it's very formal. It's very contextual. And there are too many different contexts. So if you take the other direction, if you want to say, okay, Jonathan, I buy your story, it's got some problems, I'm sure that's what my faculty will say when they see this online, it's got some problems, but I get it, okay, let's go the immanent route. Let's try to start from the natural world and describe intrinsic value without any externalities, without starting from any weird starting points we can't all agree on. Let's just start from scientific knowledge. It's something that almost everybody in the world buys into. It's the paradigm of the time. That's where we should start. That's our content. It's our context. It fits the bill. But the question is, how do you account for value just from scientific knowledge? And this is what philosophers have called the is-ought debate for a long time now. It's more of a debate for some than others. But the question is, I think a lot of that started because the idea of science, of scientific knowledge, knowledge of the natural world, is objective, right? It doesn't have my feelings or my intuitions about it involved. It's something that I can look at objectively, and I can come to the truth and understand the way the world works. I mean, I'm saying that tongue-in-cheek, right? Because that's not the way science works at all. Value's all bound up in science all the time. So if you think about my story about why the sentience folks, the people who purported sentience as a criteria for value, did so, they thought it described what happens when I kick a table, right? And I feel pain. That pain matters to me. And that, they thought, was enough. That they thought that was morally valuable. That's something we should all go on. So the question then for me has become, how do I explain mattering scientifically? Now things are going to get weird. Durr. I think the goal of biosemiotics, it's a burgeoning field developed out of several traditions, but specifically Charles Sanders Peirce, the American pragmatist, developed a semiotic theory. And semiotics is the study of communication and signification. It's a transfer of signs, is what semiotics means. Biosemiotics is the communication and signification in living systems. And biosemioticians seem to think, almost as a group, that biosemiotics accounts for signification in all living things. If the story we're telling about signification is a story about information, it's about meaning, then part of my work has been trying to argue that meaning, the meaning we give to things, let me give you one brief analogy so you don't think I'm too off the wall here. When I see a stop sign, right, and when you see a stop sign, the stop sign means the same thing to both of us, right? It's a sign for don't go any further, pause, stop. Roll through carefully, whatever it means, right? Similar things. So that sign is interpreted by us. And this is semiotics. This is an embarrassingly quick and dirty shot, right? It's the interpretation of information in our environment. Biosemioticians think all living things do this. And if they can give a scientific account, which is what they're trying to do, if they can give a scientific account of the way that happens in living things, then I think they've got an account of value. They've got an account of what it means to matter. They've got an account of why my stubbing my toe on the table and feeling pain is just the same as a sunflower turning towards the sun. That's a stretch, right? A big stretch. Again, where the problem of analogy comes back. You might think, okay, Jonathan, I buy your story. I see what you mean about semiotics and interpreting information in our world. I get it. You and I interpret stop signs the same way. We interpret pain the same way. In fact, I could even buy into the story that when a wolf is chasing a deer, the deer is feeling the same sort of fear as if a wolf was chasing me, right? I could even, okay, there's some information going on there that seems to be analogous, and of course it breaks down. So this is the job of biosemiotics, not of me. So you can't fault me for the failures of biosemiotics so far, but there's potential there, and I'm trying to give you an example of one way that we might think about natural intrinsic value and give an account of it. Like I said, sort of weird. But I think what this could do is twofold. First of all, it's a pretty clear account of, at least in my view, pretty clear account of mattering, meaning, and therefore intrinsic value to individuals. If the idea is that all living things make meaning out of their relationships to the world, their interpretation of the world, and some of that meaning matters to them, you've got an account of value, at least on my book. So you've got an account of individuals. But I think also it gives you an account of the whole. It gives you an account of relationships. And I'll give you one concept that might help explain that. German biologist, turn of the 20th century, Jakob von Uskuhl, I think, coined the term Umwelt. And an Umwelt is a worldview, the German translation. And his idea here, he gives an example of a tick, right? And so his idea, which is taken up by biosemiotics, is that all living things have Umwelten, the plural, right? And these worldviews, my worldview, for instance, is pretty big, right? I can imagine all of you and what you're feeling, and we're all related. I can imagine what's going on outside, and we're related. I can imagine global issues, people suffering in other countries, natural resources being depleted globally, right? Climate change, My worldview is big. He juxtaposes that to the example of a tick. A tick cares about three things. This is just a physiological story, right? A tick cares about heat, it cares about light, and it cares about one particular pheromone given off by mammals. That's it, right? It couldn't care less if there was climate change going on. Doesn't care if it's fallen onto my dog or Leanne, right? The tick is just caring about those three things. His worldview is very, very small. And this story applies then to every living thing. There might be some tenuousness between animal living things and plant living things, but let's just say all living things for now. And if you think about that story, it's really interesting because it's giving you a scaling property, right? It's giving you a sense that ticks care about very little, I care about a lot, and everything else is sort of in the middle. You'd think. Maybe there are things that care about more things than I do, I don't know. And you could even tell a more complicated story. For instance, my vision is not perfect, right? Maybe some of yours is better. So visually, you're caring about a wider, you're interpreting a wider range of things. Your Umwelten is bigger. Some other mammals who have much better night vision than I, for instance, at night, their worldview is different than mine and bigger. And so biosemiotics is trying to describe those scientifically. And if we can do that, we've got an account of meaning, of interpretation in the natural world, value, et cetera, et cetera. But also, if you try to draw that, for instance, if you imagine each of us has a little bubble, we're at the center of this bubble, and our Umwelt spreads out around us, all the things that we're interpreting, all the information we're taking in, all the things we're connected to, and then you imagine that for every other person in this room. That's a really messy picture. It's like a Venn diagram times 30, right? And the idea is, this is why I think you've got a picture of the whole, because every one of us affects every other person in this room and a much broader range of things too. And so maybe a tick, if you want to talk about its worldview, maybe the tick only cares about those three things, but the mammal that it's falling onto, which is part of its Umwelt, its worldview, also has its own worldview, which is related to a whole subset of things, which ultimately might even lead back to me in this room right now, right? So these interpretive connections, this meaning that you're creating, can offer you an account of the whole. And if you take that, then I think we're doing bioethics. So let me bring that back to Leopold, since we're standing in the Legacy Center now at the Aldo Leopold Foundation. Leopold's statement of the land ethic was, a thing is right when it tends to preserve the integrity, stability, and beauty of the biotic community. It's wrong when it tends otherwise. I hope by now you can see that, at least, again, importantly, at least from my perspective, as the big level, right? He's worrying about the whole. But it's hard for Leopold to offer an account, at least on this statement of the land ethic, of the value of the individual. He's worried about the whole. He's worried about biotic stability. You might tell all sorts of crazy stories, like, let's say, Ian, that you're ecologically useless. Sorry, let's just, as an example, right? We might think, well, biotic stability, that's what matters. Ian's got to go. But we don't think that. And so the land ethic, at least this statement of it, puts us in conflict with the ways, with our intuitions, with the ways we really think about value. We think, we hope, Ian matters, right? So we might say, okay, yeah, Leopold, we agree. Biotic stability is important, and maybe even of highest priority. But it can't be an account of the only good, or we're doing a disservice to the way we all feel about each other and about our pets, and maybe about some fish and a couple trees. So part of my goal, part of my project and my research is combining the land ethic with a theory like a biosemiotic theory that would take into account individual value. And together, you'd get a land ethic that would become a bioethic, right? Something that's going to account for our interrelations in the living world. So I hope, although you can't see this picture very clearly, that's Herbie having been cut down with a 52-inch bar on a chainsaw. Amazing. Right, 217 rings lying exposed. Normally that picture, if it were any other tree, and this is a really interesting thing to me too, if it were any other tree, I'd think 52-inch chainsaw bar, awesome. But instead I think Herbie, and I think, like Leopold thought, that's a long history, 217 years. Imagine what that tree saw. Imagine what that tree was able to interpret in its environment, things that we have no conception of. And I really think that's what Leopold was getting at. When he says things like, thinking like a mountain, and we all sort of think, oh, old esoteric Leopold, we have no idea what you're getting at. But thinking like a mountain, I think what he meant was everything and mountains are pushing it for me even, but everything has umwelt, right? Everything has a perspective. And it's an understanding of the interrelations of those perspectives that I think make a bioethics. So that's my story. Thank you.